name is Oliver, and I'm gonna tell you a story. It's about a young girl. She's only 15 years old and has blonde hair and blue eyes. Lives with her parents in New Jersey, and they love her very much. And one night, she and her friends decided they were gonna come to New York City. My parents are away, and I'll take their car. They will never know. We're gonna have a great time, she said. And they drove over the George Washington Bridge and drove downtown to the Limelight. Wow, look at the line. Don't worry, I know the guy at the door. We'll get in. And they did. So many people. Look at that guy's shoes. They must be a mile high. She turned around and bumped into a really cute guy. They had a good time. They danced for hours and hours, and she had a few drinks too. Hey, he said, my roommate's not home and well. I was wondering if you wanna, you know, come to my place. I just don't wanna be alone. She said, yes. So they got into a taxi and went to 3rd Avenue and 11th Street to the NYU dorm rooms and went upstairs and sat on his bed. And he said, take this pill. And she did. And then she said, what did you just give me?
Amen. We'll be right back. sharing the same dreams. Thousands of miles apart, but on the same longitude, dreaming in sync. How could that be possible? Some theorize that collective neurological activity could somehow manifest, influenced by geographical factors. The boys were immediately quarantined. We ran experiments, gauging their brain activity, mapping out their minds. The earliest results of which revealed it impossible to inhibit their telekinesis. I took advantage of a power outage to smuggle them out of the lab. At first I hid them at home. It was when my own appliances stopped working that I realized that power cut hadn't been coincidental, that the polar children were playing mind games. We left DC as the Douglas Point generators began to show signs of failure. Entire towns had blackened out in our wake. Followed. Kept hearing reports of us on the radio. Even saw our faces on a TV at a service station in Danbury, Connecticut. We had to be very careful to avoid towns, hotels, restaurants. We slept in the car. Kept heading north. Now at this point in the story, there's something very important to understand. At the onset of our journey, I had been seized by an inexplicable sensation, something that felt like it was growing inside me. And sometimes I'd wake up without remembering, having fallen asleep. The car parked in the middle of an abandoned field somewhere, and there they'd be, sitting on the hood of the car behind the windshield, just staring at me. Absences, I felt like another person. I sensed something with limitless depth of power washing over me. And there are not words to describe this sensation. One of them said to me, "Once we reach the North Pole, everything will be clear. And our real work will begin." Oh, what was going on? How many times in reality had I already made that journey with the boys? What exactly was this polar inertia? When the first snow-capped peaks glistened on the horizon, and the world that lay behind us howled and bled, we, as the century,